How are we doing this morning?
Good.
All right. So I actually got two claps from this room. That was great. So give you a little background on myself. Like he said, I'm from Ohio. I'm a retired police officer by trade. Glad I'm out of that profession right now. Wrong profession to be in. So how many of you got to see BrushPile Fishing television show? All right. You guys enjoying it? Okay. I'll tell you what, I started years ago, I had a show called Midwest Crappie. I had one cameraman, he had one of those little handy cams, and we did that for about 8 years. I look back on that now and it's like, oh my, how'd we get that on the air? But I've been lucky. I worked on some B&M videos for Bass Pro Shop when, remember DVDs when they were popular? So we did some of those. And then I got a call from a little town in it's called New Knoxville, Ohio. It's like half the size of this town, but they've got a TV cable company and all this stuff, internet. They wanted to start their own programming. So they first thing they wanted to do was a fishing show. So they called me out of the blue, and I don't know any of them. And they said, would you be interested in doing this show for us? And I said, yeah, I'd like to get back into it. I said, but it's got to be crappie fishing. I mean, and that's what I am known for. That's what I love to do. And I remember meeting at the meeting, it was a Canadian guy, had the real good Canadian accent. He used to be a Circus de Soleil guy. He had a rooster haircut, straight up like that, nothing on the sides. And I remember going home and telling my wife, I'm going to do this show. I said, they have no idea what they're getting into. It's going to last one season. And I'm happy to announce this year, here in a couple weeks, we're going to have our 100th episode. And thank you. And you know, and that means a lot to me, because unless you're Bill Dance or somebody like that, to do 100 episodes and stay on TV like we have, it's been incredible. It's been a fun ride. And you know, I want you guys, if you have questions, whether it's about the techniques we're going to talk about or the television show, just ask the questions, okay? If I don't want to answer them, I'll lie to you, okay? And I'll just tell you something completely different. So, but I'm honest about that part of it. But no, I've been lucky. It's been a great ride. And I think the thing that sets our show apart from some of the other shows, instead of you seeing me going out every week saying, well, there's a fish, crappie fishing, there are so many different patterns and techniques to catch crappie. And I used to tournament fish over the years, and I got to go to 14 national championships. Well, through that, I've made friends with some of the best tournament anglers and some of the best crappie guides in the country. So every week we go to a different lake, a different time of year with a different person. And what I do, the way I look at it, if you're my guest for that half hour show, all I am is a narrator. I want you to tell your story on this show, why you're fishing your lake this time of year, why you're doing this technique. So this is your half hour show. And I think that's what's kept us a little bit different than other shows. And we still try to make it entertaining, but we want you to be able to try to learn something. And maybe something that we did in today's show, you think, well, I can't do that whole technique on my lake, but maybe I can take a part of that and it'll help me catch more fish. And that's been our goal. So the coolest thing, I'm still like a little kid too. When I started, okay, when they called me, how many of us fish with a friend or a buddy, a wife, kid? All right, this is audience participation seminar. You have to be honest with me. How many of you have been on the lake, whether it's by yourself or with a friend, you hook into a good fish and all of a sudden you become Bill Dance. Son, there he is! Come on, who's done that? I did that all the time, okay? So when they asked me about doing a television show, I was like, yeah, let's do it. And it's still cool. We've got the brush pile truck, so you can't miss us. And it's neat when, you know, we stop to get gas or get food or something and someone comes up and say, hey, I watched the show, you know, we like it. So I know there's at least two people to watch our show and I'm thankful for them, so. But thank you guys, I appreciate you coming out today. I do a lot of seminars. COVID has put us on the back burners this year. I normally do shows in Columbus, Cincinnati, Indianapolis, all those have been canceled. This is the only one that I normally do that still has it. And if I could only pick one to go to, this is the one. And the reason I say that, when we go to some of the bigger boat shows, a lot of guys are there for the bass fishing, the walleye fishing and everything else. Everybody in this building is here because they love crappie fishing. Okay, so that's why I like doing this show. My technique I want to talk about today, and if you have questions along the way, ask, okay? I want to talk a little bit about dock shooting. We all have our favorite technique, our favorite pattern that we like to do. This is mine by far, but if you don't have docks in your home lake, listen to what we're talking about today, because you can do this not just shooting docks, but if somebody's got pontoons in the water, you can shoot under them. If you've got laydowns coming off the shoreline and you got a little space between some, you want to get in between, you can use this technique in a lot more ways than just dock shooting. But I want to talk about the springtime, especially because we've got it coming up, and I'm from Ohio, and here's the problem we have, okay? And again, we'll do a little audience participation in the seminar today. So, how many of us fish with a buddy again? Okay, we all do, all right? So, I'm taking it your weather's pretty similar to ours. So, in Ohio, say it's springtime, okay? How many of you are better fishermen than your fishing partner? Okay, all right. So, we're going to say it's first week of April, okay? And you know how spring weather can be. It's in, it's out, it's cold, it's this. Well, your buddy, you guys work together. He takes a week vacation, Monday through Friday, but he's got to work the weekend coming up. So he takes vacation. You're still at work every day at work. It's been 75 degrees. It's been sunny and the wind has been 5 miles an hour, okay? So you're sitting there working, and every day, what do we all have now that we can send pictures on? Cell phones. So he's sending you these pictures of these nice crappie, and he's telling you how the weather's been. He's telling you this, okay? How many have been there from your buddy? And it's killing you because you know, man, I'm a better fisherman than he is because you guys all told me you're better than your partner, okay? So you're thinking, if he's catching 14-inch fish today, I'd be getting 16-inch fish. And if he's got 20 in his live well, I would have 30. I'd be home by now, okay? So you work, it kills you, you get through that week, okay? And now it's the weekend. So your buddy, he took the week off, but he's got to work the weekend. So it's Friday night, you want to get all your equipment done, you go out on your boat, and you're going through your rods, you're going to do some dock shooting, you get everything ready, okay? You get into bed because you're going to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning, get a good early start. So you lay there and you keep thinking about them fish and you can't sleep. Anybody been there? I still get that way. I still do. So you finally doze off. The last thing you can remember, you seen the clock said 3 a.m., but you doze off. You're getting up at 6, but at 5 a.m., you're wide awake, okay, because you're ready. So you get up. Look, I'm not going to sleep. You get up. You throw that coffee pot on. You say, hey, I got a few minutes, it's dark. You turn on the news and the weather's on, okay? It's been beautiful here in Ohio, or here in Caruthersville, is that what he called it? It's been beautiful, okay, all week. But today's high is gonna be 34. And the winds are gonna be out in the north at 20 miles an hour steady. Anybody been there?
Yeah, boy.
Because you knew this weekend you were gonna get the last laugh on your buddy. Now he's gonna get it, right? Okay, realistically, how many of us are going back to bed right now? Okay. Here's the thing. I don't think we have any youngsters in here today. How many of us have played any sport? I don't care, bowling, golf, football, baseball. Do we get better on game day or do we get better during practice days? Fishing is the same way. If you really want to become a better crappie fisherman, if you want to become someone that catches a few more fish every time you go out, these are the days that you need to go out there. And the reason I say this, with the temperatures dropping that much, at least in Ohio, that cold front would really put a hurting on our fishing, okay? Those are the days when you go into it, you know it's going to be tough today. It's not going to be like when my buddy was fishing all week. So I am going to have to get out there and I am going to have to figure out what I can do to make these fish hit. Okay? If you do that, you're going to become a better angler. Now, does that mean that every day like this, you're going to be able to catch them? No. I would love to tell you guys that every time we go to tape a show, we get that show in 2 hours and we're heading home. Anybody know a guy named John Godwin? Godwin and I, we've done some shows in the past, turned out great. We went down 2 weeks ago, stayed at his house, and we were going to tape a show next day, 65 degrees the day before. It was 31 for the high when we got there. Guess who didn't get the show that day? Because of our schedule and his schedule. So it happens, but still, if you can get out on those days, that's when you're going to become a better angler. What I like to do, my favorite technique in the spring, you can actually do this year round, but we'll talk about spring patterns now, is dock shooting. And when I talk about dock shooting, first of all, you want to get a rod that's made for that. This is a sharpshooter 6 foot one piece rod, and it is designed for shooting, and that's what shooting is. What you're going to do, let me finish this. I got 4 pound test on. High vis line is a must. This is the slime line I'm using. You've got to get something high vis. The one thing that's kind of deceiving for me on this rod here, B&M makes this, it's got the cork cut out there so you can feel the blank, because that makes it more sensitive. Okay, and that's true. But when you're dock shooting, if you wait until you feel that strike, a lot of times it's too late. That fish has had it and he's already spitting it out. So we want to go by visual. And what I mean with that high vis line, when I shoot that, my line to where the water is, I don't want a straight angle like that. I want a loop, because what happens, here's how you shoot. First of all, I'll normally drop that down to almost where my reel is. I've got my bail open. I've got the line resting on my finger. I'm not pulling back with that finger. I'm just letting that line rest. I've got a loop knot because we're going after aggressive fish. Say today the weather's good. So I want something that's going to give a lot of action, that those fish are going to chase, because we know it's going to be a good day. This here is called a slab curly. It's made by Crappie Magnet. This tail gives unbelievable action. And if those fish are active, I want something big. I want something moving fast with a lot of action they're going to chase. I also, if I don't use a cork, and we're going to talk about cork fishing like this, but if I'm not using a cork, that means those fish are active. And I always use a loop knot. And I can show you how to, I tie the loop knot when this is over, if you want to come up. It just allows that to swim a little bit more freely. So I've got that tied on. I've got my bail open, line resting. Now, if you go to do this and you've never done it before, grab the jig by the jig head, okay? Do not grab it by the hook. If you do, you will only do that one time, okay? You will learn your lesson. So save yourself that, grab that. Now, what I like dock shooting for too, a lot of times if someone, I don't mind following somebody in a channel that just fished a dock or a pontoon, because a lot of times they're flipping 1 or 2 foot under there and that's it. But a lot of times, especially when that sun's out, those fish are in that darkest water they can find. So this technique, I'm gonna hit a lot of water nobody else can get to. So say that, you know, I've only got a hole this big, I can use it, this technique, and get exactly where I want. Now, I'm not even gonna pull back hard on this, but listen to the force of this, okay? I don't know how many feet this is between me and the wall, but it's a pretty good distance. It's bigger than most pontoons, so I can get all the way under there. And the thing is, I'm getting into areas where no one else has gotten to. So if those fish are active, again, what I want to do is from here to the water, I want a big loop in that line. Because when you see a strike, you will see that strike before you feel it almost every time. There's one of a couple ways or things that you look for. First of all, and the most prominent, is when that fish hits it, the line looks like electricity hit it. I mean, it just, it jumps. As soon as you see that, set the hook. The other thing you may see, it may not jump, but that line may go real slow one way or another, just like this, or it may go back this way. If you see that line moving, you're not feeling anything yet, set the hook. The other thing is, if you see the line come up a little bit, that fish has got it and he's just holding on. So again, you want to set that hook right away. Now, I talked about, I like using this when those fish are active, okay? And you'll know right away, because normally if I shoot and they hit it on the drop, I know, man, those fish are chasing these bait, they want it. So that's when I'll go to that big curly tail. The other thing with your electronics, and I know everyone talks about live scope today, and I've got a live scope, but you can go by with just a side imaging and look under the docks, you'll see which one have fish and ones that don't. You can also see what size are under there. Sometimes you may hit 3 docks in a row and they've got all small fish. You go to a 4th dock and that's where all the big ones are congregated for whatever reason. But I like this. Again, what I'm going to do, if they don't hit it on the drop, I'm just going to start a steady retrieve, maybe just let it drop down a little bit. If they're chasing that, that's great. If they're active, this is what I want to go to, okay? As far as the other thing is hook set. Now, so I shoot under there, and I hit that, and I see that line move, or I see that line jump. I want to set my hook. What's one of the nicknames that we give the crappie?
Paper mouth,
okay? So has anyone ever heard someone else say, don't set the hook too hard or you're gonna rip his lips out and it's gonna come out. Anybody hear that? Okay, don't think that way when you're jig fishing, okay? With minnows and a light wire hook sometimes, but if I'm shooting docks and I've got a jig on there, when I see that strike, my initial hook set, and when I talk about initial hook set, I'm sitting there, I'm doing this, from here to here, it's as hard as I can. When I see that strike, bam, okay? I set it hard. You think I'm bass fishing, because what that does, it drives that jig right up through the top part of the crappie's mouth. That's tough to get out, ain't it? Has anybody got one stuck up there? That's what your goal is. Set that thing hard. Make sure your drag's set. Set it hard. Let the drag do the rest of the work. You're going to catch a lot of crappie that way. The other thing is, I learned stuff. One of the cool things about doing this show, I've been doing this stuff for 30-something years, okay, in the fishing industry. But every time I fish with somebody new, I'm still learning things. And I think that's what keeps this cool for me. But I always use 6-pound tests when I shot docks or shot under pontoons. A couple years ago, a buddy of mine, he said, man, start using 4 and see if you notice a difference. When I went to a 4-pound test line, it makes all the difference in the world. You will see so many more strikes, and I don't know why that is. You wouldn't think there's that much of a difference, but I go to a 4-pound. Now, you do, absolutely. Yep, and you see it better. And the other thing is, if I go to that 4-pound test, I love shooting not just docks, but my favorite technique is shooting underneath a pontoon boat, especially in the early spring, because what happens, that water temperature is still cold, especially with cold fronts coming in and out. So what happens, that sun beats down on the pontoons and it may warm the water. If you take a thermometer and put it, you know, real close to the pontoon, it may be 1 to 2 degrees warmer than water 3 foot away. That doesn't sound like a bunch. It makes a huge difference. So if I'm in a tournament, I'm gonna fish that pontoon over the dock. Yes, sir.
Is that why, I mean, one time years ago on one of your shows, you like up on Lake St. Mary's or somewhere, and you said you would shoot the aluminum docks first.
Absolutely, absolutely. Especially in the spring, because that sun beats down, they warm up a little bit quicker. Okay. It brings in bait fish, and where the bait fish are, those crappie are gonna follow. But the one thing, if you're fishing the pontoons, after so many catches, what you wanna do is check the end of your line. And the reason I say that, when you set a hook on a fish, if you're under a pontoon, you know, they're going crazy under there, and it's putting friction on that line when it rubs against the metal of the pontoons. So after so many fish, just check your line, just feel it. If it feels frayed, cut it and retie on there, okay? Now, so anybody can get those fish when they're in that active pattern. Your buddy just got them all week, okay? The weather was stable, the water temperature was coming up, everything was good. But now I wanna talk about, and I wanna spend a little bit of time on this. Now I wanna talk about that weekend that you get a fish when it's 40 degrees or 30 degrees and the wind's howling, okay? How can we get those fish to bite? We know my home lake is Grand Lake St. Mary's, okay? It was hand dug, and I mean with shovels, in the 1800s. And it was made that we could make a canal system that ran all the way from Detroit, Michigan, all the way down to the Ohio River in Cincinnati. And that's what that was made for. There are no drops, no ledges, no anything. It's 6 foot. So when a cold front comes in there with that shallow water, man, it really shuts them fish down. Here's what I like. I'll switch up a little bit. Now, I'm not here to do an infomercial, so I'm not going to tell you that this is the Russ Bailey Signature Series. It's a beautiful blue and orange, okay? I'm not doing that, okay? I'm not telling you that when you leave here, you should get this because it's a great all-around rod to use, okay? But all joking aside, I designed this rod. It comes in an 8 foot and a 10.5. I've gotten over the years where bending over shooting docks at the end of the day kind of hurts my back because I'm old, all right? But now I can take an 8-footer or this 10.5-footer and I can flip almost like a bass fisherman, and I can get that jig exactly where I need it to be, just like I can shooting. The only time I can't, and I'll have to go to shooting, if we've had a lot of high rains and I only have this much space between the dock and the water, then I'll have to do that. But if I got normal space, I can take this and I'll flip under there. Now, the one problem I had is in my old Signature series, I had regular ceramic guides. And the problem was, if I was fishing in a lot of rain and I go to flip nice and easy, the line, because my eyelets are so small up there, the line would get tied up because of the rain. I went to stainless steel eyelets on this. So now, even if I'm fishing in heavy rains, I flip and that thing goes exactly where I want. And again, don't settle for just being able to flip and then wherever it lands, you start fishing. Practice at home before you get on water, flipping or shooting, and be able to get into a target that you want to. I'll give you a little secret. Some of you guys have heard this, but I want to talk about this real quick because it's a pretty cool story. So I'm doing a seminar in Indianapolis several years ago. And that seminar, there was probably 200 people in the audience. And it was in the winter, so I hadn't dock shot for several months, okay? And it takes me, a couple hours getting used to it every spring again to hit exactly where you want. But I'm doing a seminar, and there's a high school bass fishing team or a college bass fishing team right next to where I'm doing seminars, right? So I'm talking about this technique, and I'm talking about practicing. You can set a 5-gallon bucket up, start shooting under there, or get a chair, a kitchen chair. And once you start shooting under that chair every time, then start picking a specific leg of that chair, and you'll be surprised. You'll start hitting that leg. Well, I hadn't shot for several months, and one of the kids from this bass club says, "So you do this a lot?" I said, "Oh man, I love dock shooting." "Well, you pretty good at it?" I said, "Well, it's my favorite technique. It's what I do most of all." He says, "Well, hit that pole over there." There was a rail about this round, and it was farther from here to the end. It was a lot further. And I'm like, yeah, there's one in every crowd that wants to call you out, okay? So when you're called out, what are you gonna do? You're gonna try it. So I grabbed it, and real quick, I just took it, and all you hear is a ting, and the bass kids are like, "Oh my gosh." And I'm thinking, when you do something like that, you walk around like this, okay? But I can tell you guys, if I would have done that 9 more times, I'd have missed, okay? But since I did hit it that first time, I was like, yeah. And those guys come up afterward, "Man, that was awesome." You're not ready for that yet, son. But anyways, so again, this is where I want to take some time. I want to talk about cold fronts and you fishing. Again, I'm talking about docks or underneath pontoons, but if you've got laydowns or you've got brush piles in shallow water, you can use this same technique, okay? This is, a flipping or pitching rod. Now, I've got the same line on. I talked about the jig. I wanted something when those fish are active, big, bulky, a lot of action. So I use that slab curly, okay? If the fish are the opposite, if they're really locked up, and I know they're not going to chase anything, they're not going to hit it when it drops, what I'll go to, this is called teardrop float. And it's a little cork. Now, how many of us have ever crappie fished with bobbers? Okay. How many normally have used something a lot bigger than this thing? Okay. If you fished in cold front days where the bite was tough and you had a bobber, a bigger bobber, and you went home and you only caught a couple fish, I can almost guarantee you had bites on that bobber and you didn't know it. Okay. With this thing here, the way it's shaped, it's oval. So it goes into the water quick, even if a fish is finicky. But with this, I have caught so many crappie that are so finicky, they won't even take this thing under the water. If you're lucky, they'll lay it on the side and it just lays there. You can see that. But this is where the practice and the concentration comes in on them cold front days. Look for that cork. It should be sitting straight up. Look for any movement. If it goes just a little bit, that fish is there. And I've got to... Again, you got to understand, I don't have a life, okay? I've got my family, I've got baseball that I love, and I've got crappie fishing. So I actually got to study this one time doing seminars. The guy, you guys seen the big fish tanks that they bring in? He let me go up on there and spend an hour just experimenting with stuff. This is where I got to see just how effective this is. With this cork, I'll flip this jig out. Now, this jig that I have on here now, is made by Bonehead. It's called a Slim Stick. It's a lot different body style from what I just showed. This thing is one straight tail, and I want that because I don't want a lot of movement right now, okay? So what I do is I put this cork on. I've got a toothpick in there so I can adjust the depth just that quick if those fish are deeper. And again, if I go by that dock or go by that brush pile, I'll see exactly where those fish are. Here's a big benefit. So now I've seen the fish were that deep. So I've set my cork. What I'm gonna do, and say I'm fishing over that thing, okay? What I'm doing, I've got the line just resting in my hand. I'll make a little flip. And again, I can get just as far and just as pinpoint with this. But now here's the difference, okay? Before, I would let it drop. If they didn't hit, I was doing that steady retrieve, maybe pop it a little bit. They're not gonna chase it today. We've got that cold front. So what I've done now, I flipped this jig in there, and this cork is holding it there, okay? It's at the exact level I want. If I'm retrieving that jig without a cork, the other problem that you have, sometimes the fish are very finicky as far as what zone that they will strike in, okay? So if I'm out of the zone too high or I'm out too low, they're not gonna hit it. But with this, I see where those fish are, I set it. If you are fishing a cold front, say you're vertical jigging, how many of us has done this and we try to just hold it as still as we can, okay? Now I can do that from 25 foot away. I don't have to be over top of them or underneath that dock. I flip under there, and what I've got is that jig is staying exactly where I need that to be the whole time, okay? And I can take my time working it back. And here's the problem that I'll see. Now, let me give you this example too. So it's springtime, and I'm fishing one of them cold front days, and say that someone's hired me for a guide trip. I'll pull into a channel, we don't catch anything. Pull into another one, nothing. So then you're thinking, well, there's just no fish in these channels, because if I can't catch them there, they're not there. But then you pull into that third channel and you see a guy down there flipping docks and he's catching fish, okay, during this cold front. So now we get there, well, now I know where these fish are, I'll catch them. So you flip under there, you flip and you're sitting there and you're working that jig and you're watching him, he catches another. You still haven't caught him. You flip it back under there and you work, you don't catch another. The biggest key when I'm using this technique is slow down your presentation. If you think you're fishing slow, slow it down even more. And here's why I like the Slim Stick for this. Now, also, this jig head I've got on just came out, or just I was made aware of it last year. It's called an eye hole jig. Has anyone ever heard of this? I use a lot of the slab bites, the little tablet looking things. I use a ton of those slab bites. I would always put them on the hook, and I still do. But with these eye hole jigs, the eyes are cut out that you can put the slab bites in, squeeze them in there, and that scent's always there and it doesn't come out. So it's pretty slick. But what I'll do is I'll use that and I'll go to this Slim Stick. It's a different style than that. Now, I told you it's one single tail. If we hear a commercial about a jig, we always hear, this jig has great what? Action. It's got it. They do, but they don't need a lot of work from us, especially from the cold front. So what I'll do is I'll flip under there or flip a brush pile or whatever I'm fishing. And once it settles, and again, I've got to see this in them tanks, the bobber sets on the water, that jig settles down to where it's supposed to be. Even if I'm not moving that at all, that tail on that jig will sit there and just barely quiver by itself. So here's what I've got to learn by standing on them fish tanks. During them cold fronts, I'll let that jig settle down and I wait for at least 3-4 seconds. I do absolutely nothing. If I don't get a hit, I just pop it just like this, boom, boom. One or two little pops, that's it. What happens during these cold fronts or when it's finicky is when you barely pop that one or two times, that jig may raise only this much, comes up this much, and then it settles right back down. When it settles, that tail will start to quiver again. What I've seen in that tank is when you pop it, if a fish is below that, you'll see them adjust. They'll take notice of that pop, but they still won't hit it. But then after you pop it and it settles back down and just that tail quivers, those fish will come up and they'll mouth it. And you cannot, if you've got a big bobber, you absolutely cannot see that. But with that little cork, that's when you'll see that thing just go just that much. If you learn to see that and set that hook, you're going to put fish in a boat with this technique that you could have never got during these cold fronts. And I like to tell some stories where this actually came true. Some of you guys I know have sat through my seminars before, but I got to tell this story. We were down in Alabama at a writer's camp. And what a writer's camp is, we take a bunch of outdoor writers out. They take several of us B&M guys. We get photos, articles, and stuff. We were in Alabama. I'm not going to tell you his first name is Vic, okay? But there's an outdoor writer that could be named Vic from Pennsylvania who takes some of the best photos and does some of the best articles in the world and is a great guy when you are not on the water with him. When you're on the water with Vic, he is all business because he wants that money shot. Man, he will yell at you. He will scream at you, everything. Vic comes down for this writer's camp. We're down at Weiss Lake, Alabama. He flies in the afternoon. He's going to stay the whole next day and take off that evening. And he says, I want to fish some too, guys. So Vic gets down there and 75 when he gets there next morning, he gets the photos he needs that afternoon. He said, Russ, I want to fish the next day. I'm going out with these guys, spider rigging minnows. I said, okay. It snows in Alabama the next day. We talk about them cold fronts. It's not just Ohio. It snows down there. So Vic goes out with a buddy of mine. They go spider rigging with minnows. He comes in and I can tell Vic's not in a good mood. I said, what's wrong? He said, I really wanted to catch some fish here. He said, man, they will not hit. I said, Vic, we can go try it under some of the docks. He said, man, we were using live bait. If they're not hitting that, they're not going to hit any. I said, Vic, let's try it. So he said, let's go. So we did this technique. And first of all, not all outdoor riders, and I'm not saying Vic is this way, but some of them named Vic can't fish worth a lick, okay? They can write great articles, but they can't. So Vic, I'm showing him how to shoot under there. He's having a hard time getting it under. So finally, I take it and I shoot it. And I've got this cork on, and I'm not fishing. I'm watching. And I see that little movement I talked about, just that little quiver. I said, set the hook. Well, he's late, and he misses it. So we get him back under there, and I'm watching. I said, set the hook. And after about two or three times, he said, man, you're just messing with me. I'm not getting hits. It's not going. I said, you got to trust me on this. I said, it's not going to go under. It's just doing this. So we get under there, and I was ready to say, set. And as soon as I said that, he seen it. And man, he set the hook, got a pound fish, and he ends up catching probably 10 or 11 in the next half hour that were all good quality fish. I got a real good article on cold front crappie right then, because this thing, I don't know what this costs, 49 cents or whatever. But you pair that up with a jig that you want to work on its own, and man, it can make all the difference in the world. So when those cold fronts come in, don't give up on them days to go fish, because that's the day if you go out and you concentrate and you figure out what movement does that crappie want. And you figure out, I can see just that little twitch now. If you start doing that, if you can put fish in the boat on them cold front days, just think what you can do when it's like your buddy was fishing. Yes, sir.
What weight head do you use there on that setup?
That one is a 1/32. If it's a cold front, I like to go to a 1/48 even. Okay? Because I want very little movement on there. Very little movement. And again, not trying to turn it into an infomercial, but the Russ Bailey Signature Series is great for small jigs, big jigs, or whatever size you want to use. Okay? So I'm just saying. But no, I like light during them cold fronts. Okay? I didn't bring this up, but since you did, I'm going to talk. So one of the other things we did, you see these pretty orange rings? And my wife, I did a seminar one time, and I was talking about the rod and the benefits and this and that, and she got mad when I was done. She said, you didn't tell them the most important thing. I said, what? She said, that is a really pretty rod. You guys think that's pretty? Huh? I can tell my wife. I told her. But these rings are in 1-foot intervals. So say I'm vertical fishing, okay, and those fish are 4 foot down. Instead of guessing when I get back, move it to 4 foot, get back in the water, saves you some time. So thank you for bringing that up. So, but anyways, like I say, I always like talking about cold front crappie because it's a lot of times where guys, I think, will give up and not even try. And this is where we can really refine our techniques. So, and this is just one pattern. I love dock shooting, but remember, this can be used in other ways. If you've got laydowns or brush piles, you want to get in between. The key is whether you're doing the long flipping or you're doing the shooting, The first time you ever try this, don't wait till you get on the water to try it, okay? Get a bucket at home. Within 15 minutes, you'll be shooting under a chair every time. I guarantee it. And then when you get out on the water, you're comfortable with it, okay? One key, I told you that I like fishing underneath pontoon boats. Say if I was in a tournament and I have 15 minutes left and I've got a wooden dock and I've got a pontoon boat, I'm hitting that pontoon every time because for whatever reason in spring, they hold more fish. One key, okay? Until you get really good at flipping or shooting, if you look at the back of a pontoon in the center, you've got a motor, okay? And then you've got the two cutouts, one on each side. On this side of the cutout, normally, it's just a cutout, plenty of room to shoot. On the other side, a lot of times they got a gas line or an oil line coming down there. Until you get real good, stay away from that side, okay? Because you're going to go, choo-choo-choo-choo. And then you're going to be saying, that damn Russ Bailey, why did he even tell me about this technique, okay? Stay away from that side. But once you get pretty good at shooting, you'll have no problem shooting even under them gas lines. And again, one of the keys to this, you are going to get into places nobody else is fishing, okay? If you pull up to a dock or a pontoon or something and you've got a lot of spider webs there, it may take you a couple shots to get in there and get all the spider webs cleared out, but you know no one has hit that water this morning, okay? Any questions on this? Yes, sir. Correct. He asked, on the 8-footer, I'm flipping, not shooting. That is correct. And I've gotten to the point now where I can flip that about as far as I can shoot and be as accurate. Yep. Yep. Now, the other thing, on that cork, I told you it's pegged with a toothpick, okay? So normally, if the fish are about this deep, that's what I do, peg it. What if those fish are running deeper? Because now it's harder to flip under something because you get the bobber up here, and the jig's clear down here, so they're going to get messed up. You can take, you know, the little beads we use for slip knots and the rubber stoppers that bass fishermen use for their weights, put one of them on there, and now you've made a slip knot so you can shoot and fish as deep as you want with that technique. And again, it keeps that bait in the strike zone 100% of the time. You never have to worry. So if I'm fishing 25 foot away, the whole time that I work that bait back, it is always, always, always in the strike zone. And you can work it as slow as you want. So good question. Any other questions? The one more thing while Wade's handing these things out, and this is completely off the subject of dock shooting, but I told you guys that every time I'm doing shows, I still learn things. Sometimes from the anglers I'm with, sometimes I just learn things. Long line trolling. Anybody long line troll? I did so much of that this past summer. I had a blast, okay? But we were in Alabama. Did anybody see the show from Weiss Lake a couple weeks ago? Let me tell you about that show, okay? I told you this slab curly has got a lot of action, okay? It's got that curly tail, and that's what we started out using, the crappie, because when you're long lining, a lot of times that's a reaction bite. They're not necessarily feeding, it's reaction. So you want something with that, you know, it's going to get their attention. We had those on at first. That water was so cold and deep, we couldn't get very many fish to hit on that. So we took that off. Have you guys seen the regular crappie magnet? It's just about that big and two little straight tails that don't even move hardly. Every fish on that show was caught on them. Long lining, where normally you think you have to have something with a lot of action. So think outside the box sometimes if you're having a hard time catching fish too, because until that day, I would have never believed we were going to catch them fish long lining on that jig that we did. Because always, that's all I've used. Because again, I'm going for that reaction bite. So think outside the box.
What inspired you to put the crappie magnet on?
Because of that tail? Oh, you mean because it's like, man, we were slowing. The fish were like 30 foot down. So I knew we were going slow. And it's like, if they're not hitting anything like that, maybe a finesse bait. It's like a bass fisherman during cold front. So I put on my crappie finesse bait, I call it, and it worked. And I would have never, ever thought that.
Give him a round.
Thank you. Thank you.
You'll be here all weekend, leaving Sunday?
I've got to leave Saturday around noon, especially now because we're calling for 5 to 8 inches of snow back home on Saturday evening. Yeah.
That's so. It. There you go.
Hey, like I told you, if I can only do one show a year, it's Grizzly Tackle. I love it here, so. Thank you guys for coming out. Hopefully you win a door prize here.